Remember last time I was in Boston, he was swole. He was like, you know,
blessed be the name of the Lord. also highly interactive, and the words are going to give you a little bit of an idea of what to do. After the hallelujahs, we're going to do shake a friend's hand, shake a hand next to you, right? So then there'll be some other motions, directions, so, you know, please follow. Do what the words say, okay? Oh, yeah. Recommended the Fruit Loop to my massage lady. Okay. Oh my goodness, she was blowing up my phone last night. She's like, this is the best experience ever. Right? That's a testimony that I shared with her, and now she has a testimony, now she's sharing it, right? And I just can't get over like how we impact each other and how our testimony is woven together and how the Lord is using us and using our church in our lives and in our friends' lives and in the people we're going to share and be like, we just had baptism Sunday and it was legit. where I just got baptized at Baptism Sunday, and it was so cool. My life will forever be changed.
Maybe we have a testimony we forgot about.
Maybe you've been a Christian for so long, you're like, oh yeah, that's old news. It ain't old news! That is good stuff right there. And I want to encourage you guys to share that. I want to encourage you to share your testimony. Because God is going to use it. God's going to use you in mighty ways. And I already know it. So let's sing about your love, O Lord. And let's lift our voice to the King of Kings.
Your love, O Lord,
reaches to the heavens.
Reaches to the heavens.
Your faithfulness. Stretches to the sky,
stretches to the sky.
Your righteousness,
your righteousness is like the mighty mountains.
Your justice flows like the ocean's tide.
Your justice flows.
Lift my voice.
I will lift my voice.
just want to thank you so much for, first of all, just creating the beauty that we have. You just so show how majestic and awesome and brilliant you are by just looking at our beautiful surroundings today. And thank you for allowing us to be out here today and worship with you. I thank you for these songs that teach us about how much you love and forgive and the mercy that we don't deserve, that you give to us and we just take for granted often, and how much you really have given up everything for us so that we can enjoy life eternal with you. This is just a temporary dwelling that we put so much effort and time into that really isn't going to be our real reality, which is going to be serving you and living and loving you for the rest of our lives. I want to thank you for that. Thank you for these people who have taken the time to come out today and to worship along with you. Be with Matt as he gives us the word. Be with the people who have chosen to show us that they are a Christian and they want to serve you with their lives, and they want to show that by being baptized today. And I just pray, Father, that if anybody's here that first of all needs to accept you as their Lord and Savior, I pray that they would do that. Or if they feel the need to follow you in baptism, that they would have the courage to just do it on the spot today. Thank you again for your love and for today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Psalm 118, it says, "This is the day the Lord has made." I want us all to say that together real quick. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Isn't that so good? I know, I love it. It's one of my favorites. All right, say hi to the people around you. If you need to move, get some sun out of the sun, whatever you got to do. It's going to be awesome. So good to see you guys.
Yeah, just grab sandwich. You know, they when they were stuck.
Yes. Well, I'm back. One of my friend's coworkers. She said, "Hey, she texted me 2 weeks ago. Hey, no, I said, okay, I'll meet you there."
Is she here?
No, she. Well, she's still a new Christian.
Good morning, everybody. Welcome back to your church.
I know.
Baptism Sunday, it doesn't get any better than that. Hey, a couple things we want to get started with. This is a good time to recognize Eric and Bree Cadwell for providing this awesome venue. Thank you, Eric and Bree. Welcome to our outdoor service, Baptism Sunday. Thank you for the air quality index, which is a real blessing. Thank you, Jesus. Got a few announcements. If you look in front of you, you won't find a connection card. However, we do have the Compass app, and we would encourage you all to jump on that app and submit prayer requests. If you're first time here, we'd like to know about you and get to know you, and somebody from staff would reach out to you and make a connection. We got a few announcements this morning. First off, Jan Colley, if you will come up. This is Jan's assistant.
This is my assistant, Roxy.
Say hi.
Hi.
All right. So Roxy and I are announcing Bible Study Fellowship again. Compass is going to be hosting it this year. I'm very excited. It's a verse-by-verse Bible study. We're going to study the Gospel of John starting September 12th and going, I think it ends May 7th. There will be breaks, don't worry. But it's a really great study. A lot of you have already signed up, and I'm really excited. Kathy is going to be one of our leaders, which is awesome. Woo! So, it's a party. No, you, if you guys want to sign up, come and talk to me, and I can get you signed up. It'll be Tuesday nights at 6:30 p.m. So come and see me if you have any questions.
Thank you, Dan. Hey, I was remiss. If you don't know me, my name's Skip. I'm one of the members of the Elder Board here at Compass Church and serve with a bunch of dedicated, awesome guys to serve you guys. Kelly Jones, come on up.
Kelly. Yeah.
Hey, good morning. Matt told me today was Dalmatian Sunday. And I was the only one who dressed for it, so can't figure that one out. So anyway, hey, I have a class coming up on the Monday, August 21st, called it's a Compass U class. We do these from time to time on different topics in the Bible, and this one's called Prophecy for Dummies, which all of us would qualify. And it's just an overview of prophetic events and defining words that people use all the time when they talk about prophecy, like the rapture, the Antichrist, 666, all those kind of good things. And, you know, people have assumptions that they've made they've maybe really never really looked into. One would be this. I've had people tell me, well, Satan has been kicked out of heaven. And I tell them, no, he hasn't. He still has access to heaven. And if you don't believe that, read Job. And read Revelation 12. He does get kicked out of heaven. We're going to talk about that. When does that happen? And what are the events that lead up to that? So anyway, there's a lot of great things. It's about an hour and a half long. We're going to try to have childcare, and you can just sign up at the church next Sunday, or just text, email me at kelly@compassbend.com. Thanks.
Joanne Nyquist, you have an announcement. Here she comes.
Good morning, Compass. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Isn't it a lovely day today? Gosh, I'm so excited to be out here. Women's Ministry is having their final summer food truck Friday, this Friday, the 18th, 5:30. And I believe it's called On Tap. I don't have my slide to help me. It's on Cushing Drive, and we're gonna meet at 5:30 and have our final Food Truck Friday. And then for all the women that are interested in the women's retreat, the registration has opened. It's $185 for the weekend. That covers your lodging and your food and all of the speakers. So. We have a sign-up sheet at church. Let Crystal and I know, and we'll get you all the information you need to get signed up. Thanks.
Thank you, Jan. You all join me in prayer, and we will get this service started. Father God, we again praise you. We thank you for this glorious day you have given us. Just enjoy your beauty you've created out here. We thank you for our worship team. And all the work they put into setting up out here. We lift up Matt now as he comes to bring the word and begin a new series. We just pray for his boldness, and we open our hearts and our minds to receive that message. And thank you for your love, your grace, and your mercy. In Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen.
Thanks, Skip. Here's your note, Skip. Don't want to not have that from all the notes you take for my sermon today. I'm going to untangle myself because I'm a walker. I tend to walk around a little bit, which also means I steal music stands. Hey, my name's Matt. I'm psyched to have you guys here, and I want to welcome you guys to our annual outdoor baptism service. Along with Christmas and Easter, this is one of my favorite services of the year, because although we can do baptisms at any point in the year, there's just something special about coming together outside, hanging out, celebrating baptisms in the middle of summer. There's something really neat about doing a service outside in nature that culminates with people getting dunked to profess that they are choosing to follow Jesus and they identify with him. So I'm excited to have you guys here. And if you were here last week, You heard that dunking actually is a technically correct term for baptism. I'm not going to go over all of that, but you can check it out online on our YouTube channel or our website. But this morning is all about the decision that people have made to follow Jesus and be obedient to his call to be baptized in the name, singular, of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, showing that God is triune in nature. He's three persons, but one God. And they are excited, and I am excited to be baptizing them today. But since you're here, since you're all sitting down, and it seems like you guys want to hear some Bible, I figured I would introduce the series we have coming on. So, that's what this morning is also going to be, an introduction to our service, our series. The name of this series is derived from a term that I've heard most often used in sports, but it's not only in sports. You can hear the term all in a number of different areas in life. And I'm not sure if you've ever played a sport or if you've ever been in a play or part of a band or work project or even a marriage. There comes a time when you need to decide that you are all in. You are either all in or you're not. The Christian life is no different. If you want to get the success that you desire or your team desires or your spouse desires, then you've got to be all in. And so that's what this series is all about. It's funny how things happen, though, isn't it? Like, this past week, I took Avery up to Seattle, my son. We had a boys' trip up to Seattle. We watched the Seahawks. They won on Thursday night. That was exciting. We watched the Mariners. They won on Friday night. That was exciting. The fireworks afterwards were outrageous. I'll tell you more about that later. But as we were up there, we sat down in our seats for the Mariners game on Friday, waiting for the game to start, and an advertisement comes up, a campaign comes up on the big screen. Now, those screens are gigantic, first of all, but we were pretty close to them. But as we were sitting there, here's what came up. Are you all in for Seattle? Are you all in for Felix? It was Felix Hernandez, Seattle Hall of Fame weekend, and they were promoting this idea that if you are all in for this baseball team of yours, come celebrate this Felix Hernandez Hall of Fame weekend with us. And this series had been chosen for months. The series has been planned for months. The title was chosen at that time, All In. And then we're sitting in seats in Seattle, and all of a sudden it's like, are you all in? And I thought to myself, God, you're awesome. Because yes, we are. Not just for the Mariners, although I am rooting for the Mariners to make the playoffs, but also in life. And so in life, we come to these points where we have to decide whether we are going to be all in or we're going to be less than that. In my sport of track and field, that's what I did in high school. I did that in college. I ran post-collegiately for a while. It's something that must be asked before workouts, during workouts, after workouts, before races, sometimes even during races, and after races, because recovery takes work as well. So are you all in? It's important that we understand whether we are there before, during, and after a situation. And for all you weekend warriors out there, remember to properly warm up and cool down, because recovery is important. However, in track and field, I remember one race shortly after I met Hillary. And it was the summer of 2004. Nope, sorry. 2003. And Hillary and I had just met. And I was training pretty hard that year. And I was hoping to do a lot of things that year. The Olympic trials the next year, I was hoping to do a lot of things there as well. But when I met Hillary, I started to question whether I was going to be all in hurdling anymore, because I had an opportunity to spend time with a beautiful young lady that would eventually be my wife. And Hillary vied for my time and attention, not to try to take me away from hurdling, but her beauty drew me in. I mean, if you've seen her, you know. But when I met Hillary, I was running for the Greater Boston Track Club. And after meeting Hillary, it was more or less like I was jogging for the Greater Boston Track Club, if you know what I mean. I was attending practice less. I was working less hard at practice. And I'd be lying if I didn't mention that at that time as well, one of my friends was working security at Fenway Park, and I went to far more games than I ought to if I'm really all in for hurdles or my relationship with Hillary, for that matter. But in July of that year, there was what they called a high-performance track meet. And I was fortunate enough to be invited to it. And as I got there, I knew I hadn't trained well enough to face the competition that I was about to see. I knew that my training was far less than it had been in years past. So when the gun went off, I was the last one to react to the gun, and I was definitely the last one over the first hurdle. Now, I wasn't the greatest out of the blocks, but this start was going to give my finish more than I thought my body could catch. I was gonna have to finish in a way that I hadn't finished really before. And at the fifth hurdle, I was still last, just about in the middle of the race. And at the fifth hurdle, I thought to myself, Matt, because when you think yourself in situations like that, you talk third person, right? Yeah. But Matt, you invited Hillary here to watch this race. She may be here watching you. And if you want any future with her, you better get your head right and race. And I hadn't seen her yet, but nonetheless, she might be there. Now, I didn't know this, but she walked into the facility just about when my race was being announced. And she saw my pathetic start and my more than pathetic first, second, third, fourth, and fifth hurdle. Thankfully, just remembering that she was there kicked my butt back into the race. And as I had thought, I hadn't been all in regards to my training. I hadn't been, if I'm honest. But if I was gonna get a chance to be all in with this wonderful young lady that I had met, I better get into this race and show her that I'm something to keep. Now, at the fifth hurdle, going over the fifth hurdle, I was 8 out of 8 athletes. I was last. And I thought to myself, is it even worth trying to pass anybody? Then the picture of of Hillary came in. And before the seventh hurdle, I passed 2 people. I passed 2 more people over the 8th hurdle. I passed 2 more people over the 9th hurdle. And as I went over the 10th hurdle, I passed the final person to take the lead. And with 45 meters to the finish of the race, I ended up winning the race by 4 or 5 meters. And I was psyched. I was exhausted, but I was psyched. And as I crossed the finish line, I noticed that Hillary had walked in with a couple of my friends. She was standing right near the starting line of the 4th lane where I had started. I hadn't noticed her before that, but I was so thankful that I had come to my senses in that race so I could win the race and she would keep me. Although she's not as shallow as I am, so she maybe would have anyway. But nonetheless, I had won the race. I had won what I thought was a future with this great woman. And the rest of the story is actually playing out right now as we've moved across the country, we've decided to follow God, we have a couple new kids, and this whole new life, this whole new worldview is what we're trying to live out now. And as I'm sure you know, the idea of being all in is one that resounds throughout society and culture. Being all in, whether it's in school for all my students here today, whether it's in a sport, whether it's at work, or whether it's even for a diet that Hillary and I may be starting soon because I'm not as thin as I was when I raced that race. We are constantly and consistently making decisions and evaluating whether we want to be all in or not. I truly believe that when we go all in on the life that Jesus offers us, as we go all in on living out the life that the way the Bible calls us to live, we will further grasp a deeper meaning to what Jesus tells us in John 10:10. In the Gospel of John, chapter 10, verse 10, Jesus says this: "The thief comes only to steal and destroy and kill. I come that you may have life and have it abundantly." There are many voices in this world that will tempt you and entice you to dismiss the effort of living the life that Jesus calls you to live. And that voice that he's speaking of that comes from the thief is that voice that tempts you and entices you not to live a godly life, to strive to live a holy life. The thief makes it sound like the life that he speaks of will give you everything you ever wanted, but in the end, it only ends with loss, death, and destruction. And I don't mean only the eternal life, although that's the majority of it. I mean the life we live now, day to day. But the voice of Jesus tells us that if we come to him, he will give us life. Whole life. an abundant life. A few weeks ago, we talked about the power of testimony. You heard Sarah talk a little bit about testimony today during the worship music. But during that sermon, the power of testimony, I encourage you to prepare your own 5-minute sermon. And actually, I told you that was your homework assignment. Do you remember that? Well, now it's time to check the work. No, I'm just kidding. I'm not going to actually check whether you did your homework or not. But the purpose of having a testimony prepared is so you can share it with people when the opportunity arises. You are prepared, as it tells us in 1 Peter 3. You are prepared to explain the hope that you have in the midst of this crazy and messed up world. And one of the benefits of thinking of your testimony prior to sharing it is that you are sure to know it and include everything you actually want to include that you might otherwise forget. Have you ever told a story, which really is what a testimony is? It's tethered to the truth of Scripture, but a testimony is a story. It's your story. Have you ever told a story and forgot to include a part that you really wanted to include? Only later on you were like, man, I should have said this. I forgot all about it. Well, preparing your testimony will allow you to share everything you want to share in a timely manner so that you can help people understand who Jesus is and why you chose to follow him. And by including everything you want, that allows you to share the story more effectively. Well, when I was doing some of the homework assignments for myself, because when I tell you to do something, I also do it. But as I was preparing my 5-minute testimony, I realized it was a part of my testimony that I don't often include. And so I thought about it and I put it down, and ultimately it didn't make the cut for my 5-minute testimony. It's probably part of my 10-minute testimony, but when you only have 5 minutes, you can't include a ton of stuff. But when I look back over my life, before I was a believer, before I chose to follow Jesus, and afterwards, when I look back over my life, it's amazing to realize that God had pursued me my entire life. He pursued me just like he did the lost sheep. He pursued me when I was 6 years old, when my neighbors who lived downstairs from me in the apartment complex we lived in invited me to their church called Grace Chapel in Lexington, Massachusetts. But even at that young age, I resisted God's grace that he offered. I didn't want it. He pursued me when I was 10 years old, when somehow I got invited to a Christian summer camp and heard about all the cool stuff that Jesus offers you if you are just willing to follow him. But at 10 years old, I wasn't willing to follow him. I would have called him God, but I wouldn't have called him Lord. He pursued me at 13 years old when my brother started dating a woman or girl who was a Christian, and we started attending her life called Abundant, or her church called Abundant Life. Abundant Life Church. But the deeper meaning of what it means to have an abundant life was lost on me when I was 10 years old. Thankfully, though, God continued to pursue me, and I eventually decided to go all in on the life that Jesus called me to. But it was really neat looking back and seeing how God drew me to him using the very things that drew me away from fully committing to Jesus. I had a hard time accepting grace. Yet the first church I was invited to was called Grace Chapel. I had a hard time thinking I needed to be part of community. Yet I went to this camp and found community. I misunderstood what it meant to have an abundant life, which was actually the name of the church that my brother's girlfriend had attended. It's amazing how when you can look back at your life, you can see God intervened and God was present even when you didn't acknowledge him. This series that I'm only introducing this morning talks about the practical steps for what it means to be all in as a disciple of Jesus in the 21st century. In this series, we will discuss what it means to be obedient to Jesus' command that he gave to his disciples in Matthew 16. In Matthew 16, verse 24, it says this: Then Jesus told his disciples, quote, "If anyone would come after me, if anyone wants to be my disciple, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me." Now, we've talked about this verse before, but this series reiterates the importance of this quote that our Lord and Savior gave to his disciples. And it divides it into three applicable steps for us to use in our lives, not just on Sunday morning, but throughout the week. I call it a three-step command. That's really what it is. It has three steps. The three steps are to deny yourself, to take up your cross, and to follow Jesus. So over the next 3 weeks, we'll do a deep dive into each of these action steps, discussing how these commands can be included into the life of any 21st century Christian. Because although life looks very different now than it did to the disciples that Jesus actually spoke these words to, the playbook of how life is to be lived has not changed. Amen?
Amen.
I want to close this part of this morning. Like I said, this is only introduction. This morning is all about celebrating the choice that people have made to follow Jesus Christ and be obedient to his call to be baptized. So I want to close this morning with a prayer. And after we pray, we're gonna have a last song that illustrates what baptism is all about. And when I finish this prayer, if you've chosen to make that public demonstration that your soul has been washed clean, white as snow, if you've chosen to make the decision to be baptized this morning, if you've told us about it already, awesome. If you're making the choice right now, this morning, and you say, you know what? There's something unique about this Jesus guy. When I truly investigate and look at the different worldviews and how to view the world, it makes most sense that this whole Christian worldview aligns. If you're someone who's made that decision this morning or you're considering that decision, come talk to us. We'd love to talk to you. But if you're willing to make that decision and not only call Jesus God, but call him Lord of your life and hand over your life to him, you too can be baptized. Just like the Ethiopian eunuch that we talked about last week, who chose to follow Jesus as Philip explained the gospel to him. He chose to follow Jesus and he saw water and he said, hey, there's water. What prevents me from being baptized? And if you've chosen to follow Jesus and you understand the cost of discipleship, the cost of following him, then nothing prevents you from being baptized either. We'd be excited to baptize you. But after I pray, and we close with this one song, if you're going to be baptized this morning, come meet Kelly Jones right over here next to that black Ford Explorer underneath that window. And if you are here to celebrate those baptisms, we are psyched you're here, because that's what this is. In that story of the Ethiopian eunuch we talked about last week, he left and rejoiced after he was baptized. That's why this is a celebration. That's why we specifically call it an outdoor baptism celebration. Because we celebrate that. But if you're here to celebrate alongside that, we're excited to have you here. You can make your way to the right side of the dock by walking on the right side of the house. Right side of the dock, right side of the house. And we're going to get over there in a few minutes. We're going to live stream our baptisms as well this year. So they'll be live streamed. But so if you're getting baptized, come over here. If you're here to celebrate, go over here. And we'll convene over there about 10 or 15 minutes after the service breaks. But we're going to sing a song first. We're going to sing a song all together. With our adults, our teens, and our young ones together here today, we're going to sing a song all together that talks about what baptism really means, what it displays. So, with that being said, let me go ahead and pray for us real quick, and then we'll come up and sing that last song after I give Sarah back her mic. Lord, thank you so much for providing us evidence to not only understand that a life can be changed, but that you are a living and loving God. Lord, thank you so much for the people that today have chosen to declare their alliance with you, that you are not only God of the universe, but you're God of us and you're Lord of us. And we're so excited to call you Lord and follow after you, and that's what this baptism represents. Our old selves dying, our new selves rising up as a new creation, just as you promised. Lord, we're thankful for this outdoor service. We're thankful for the weather you provide. We're thankful for the air we can breathe today without any, without much smoke in it. And Lord, we just thank you for the opportunity to worship you both musically, baptismally, not sure that's a word, but God, you know what I mean? And just with our lives. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. The song that we're going to sing, some of you guys are familiar with it. We've been singing it at church. For those of you who maybe are joining us for the first time today, for our kids and our teens, there's a couple spots that I want to just tell you the words ahead of time so that when those places come, you guys can sing with us loudly. During the verses, there's this great line that we all sing that goes, "I'm so glad he changed me." And we're talking about how God has transformed our lives. And then the chorus goes, "There's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine." It's talking about how we've become a new creation in Christ. "And I've met the author of my story, and he's mine, and he's mine." And then the bridge is great. And I want, when we get there, I want you guys to sing this as loud as you can. It goes, "I am who I am because the I am tells me who I am." It's kind of a play on words. "I am who I am because the I am tells me who I am." So let's sing it together as we just prepare to celebrate with those who are choosing a new life in Christ through baptism today.
Amen. And we're going to invite the ushers to come forward and take tithes and offerings as well.
Change me, darkness held me down, but Jesus pulled me out. park. And I love theme parks. I laugh like I have nothing better to do. It's a problem. Okay? I laugh hysterically. I don't scream. I don't freak out. I laugh hysterically, and I cannot control it. Okay? So I'm going down this thing. It's like 90 degrees. We've waited in line for like an hour. We are hot. We're ready to get wet. We go down this thing. It's like Splash Mountain, right? We finally get in, and we're sitting down, and we're just like, oh, this is going to be awesome. And we start going up the mountain, and all this murky water comes back because we're sitting in the very last one. I'm like, oh, that's disgusting. I'm like, kind of grossed out. I'm a little bit of a germaphobe, if you don't know, okay? So I'm kind of freaking out a little bit. I'm like, oh, that's gross. And I look over, and I say, ugh, let's keep our, like, keep your mouth shut. Let's screw it up. Totally forgetting the fact that I cannot contain myself, okay? So we're going over the tip, and I just burst out into laughter. I am just having the furious just covering my body, right? Because I know I'm going into this murky water with my mouth open, and I don't know what to do, and I can't stop it, okay? I thought forever my life was going to be changed that day. I swear, I was like, I went home to the emergency. Oh, yeah, I was just covered. I'm spitting out water. I'm, like, gagging. I'm thinking, oh, Lord, help me now. Jesus is coming. I'm sure of it. Right? I was, like, freaking out. And I want to say that story because we're doing baptisms. And Matt just said, are you all in? And I feel like there is someone here who's never been all in with Jesus. Or maybe you've been baptized, but you have. Today's the day. Today's the day. You know, I thought that day my life was going to change. Praise the Lord, it didn't. But today could be your day that everything changes for you. And I want to encourage you, even if you have a little glimpse of, I think that this could be something that I want to go all in with. I was all in going up that mountain. There was no way I was getting out. I had to do it. I knew it. I was going in. And if you feel the Lord tugging on your heart and calling you by name, I want to challenge you guys to go hang out by that car garage over there and just listen to what Kelly has to say. And if that is something that you want to do, do it. And we are going to be celebrating right alongside of you guys over there. And this water over here is a lot cleaner than what I went through. I'm just saying. This is good stuff over here. So let's do it. Yeah? Let's go. All right. If you're interested, you got this. We are going that way, and then we're going this way.
Thank you, Sarah. Hey, real quick, as you head over there, feel free to put your feet in the water or sit in the water. Just make sure there's a little open space for people to walk in for baptism. Hang out on the dock, put your feet in the water. Siri says it's 74 degrees. I think Siri's a liar, but she's wondering that. But hey, get over there, stay cool. We'll be over there in about 10 minutes. Siri just told me she's not a liar, it's 74 degrees. So, whatever. All right, we'll see you over there.
Yeah. Yep, there you go. Yeah. There you go. Yeah, I
yeah. Oh, that's not.
I want to warm him up.
Yeah, that's okay.
Thanks, Sherry, for saying that, though. This is my job, Sherry.
Okay.
This is why my family came.
I'm so excited about tonight.
Yeah.
Baptist is here. Great Glory Church is probably this way. More towards Corona area. But you'll find it. It's off the 91. It's only, that's the big freeway there.
The 91.
It gets bad. Do with an uncounted. Yeah. I won't have to search. We drove our cars. We looked everywhere. We could not find that plane. So maybe somebody picked it up and then we got there in the grassroots yard. We looked at trees. We could not find it. So, yeah,